Well, it's the flood levee dividing a town, homes protected at the expense of others and residents left feeling like sacrificial lambs, as they've said on our show. Now residents on the wrong side of the Great Wall of Echuca are coming together threatening to take legal action against council, who they believe could have done more to save their homes.
To discuss, we're joined by Justin Quill, partner at major law firm Thompson Gear in Melbourne. Justin, really nice to see you this morning. It's a fascinating case. Do you reckon that they've got a case here?
Yeah, they probably do. I mean, their first problem, I guess, is to find out who it is they're going to sue, because I haven't seen a bigger case of finger-pointing than this. You've got the council saying, look, it's not us, it's Emergency Management Victoria, and you've got Emergency Management Victoria saying, oh, no, the council were in on all our discussions about the placement of the levee. So both of them are pointing the finger at each other. So they've got to work out who they're going to sue. But once they work that out, they've got a reasonable case. It's going to be a class action in negligence, saying the levee caused worse flooding. They won't be able to say it caused the flooding, but they'll be able to argue, and this is what the case will turn on, that the flooding was worse as a result of the levee.
Okay, so we had the mayor, the local mayor, on our program last week, about this time last week. She categorically said that council was told by SES that that's exactly where it needed to go. And then fast forward to earlier this week, and I saw Victorian officials saying all the main players were consulted, as you were pointing out. Now, if no one knows what happened, that surely that opens up the case even more.
Yeah, look, absolutely. And it's not just about the placement of the levee, it's about the timing of the levee. If the levee was built early, it might have been able to be built in a different and better place. Keep in mind, of course, though, even if the residents win on the wrong side of the Great Wall of Echuca, win the case, that doesn't necessarily mean it was a bad idea to build the levee. Those residents might not want to hear this, but it might actually be better off globally for a small number of residents to be paid compensation than let's not build this levee at all, and they lost the whole town through flooding. So, as I say, those residents on the wrong side of the levee probably don't want to hear that. But, if you look at the big picture, it might actually be a case of the compensation that is ultimately needed to be paid to them. It was better than having the whole town go under and possibly even facing a bigger class action from every resident in town.
Yeah, I mean, and when we also learnt that the money was there to build that levee back in the 90s and council decided against taking that action, I wonder if that plays into the case. And look, what do you think their chances are of being successful? If they're successful, what would they potentially be entitled to?
Well, look, we're talking about money here, ultimately. Money is really the only remedy. And do I think they're going to be successful? Look, I think they've got a case, there's no question. The real turning point, as I think I said earlier, is going to be on them having to prove the levee made the flooding worse. There's no way they're going to be able to say we wouldn't have been flooded if it wasn't for the levee. That obviously they were going to have floodwaters at their house and in their houses. It's a question of what did the levee make it worse? And so that's really, I think, once you work out who the defendant is, that's really what it's going to turn on. What are they potentially going to get? A fair bit of money. I mean, only as recently as 2019, and there's been other examples of this, but 2019... the flood victims from the 2011 Queensland floods recovered, $450 million, or just over $450 million. So, now, look, that'll be cold comfort to those people who've effectively lost their homes and their possessions. But really, that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about money to try and compensate them for the loss of those homes and possessions.
Well, I mean, I'm loathe to encourage anyone to take legal action. I'm sorry to burst your bubble. But in this case, I think it'll be fascinating to see just the lines of communication, who actually made those decisions. It'll be a much bigger case than just the residents going for after the council. It'll be much more interesting to see where the tentacles actually lead to and the decision-making of councils over local people and how they get it wrong. Good to talk to you, my friend.
Thanks, Justin.
OK, flood victims, they're eligible for emergency payments as well, we learned this morning. They'll have to have the funds taxed as income because the federal government failed to make an exemption. Can you clear that up for us this morning?
Yeah, so firstly, I don't want to contribute destructively to any people who are still facing the floods around the country in northern Victoria or northwest New South Wales as they watch you on their TVs this morning. It's a really awful time for people, and we've got so many flood victims now in Australia. The hits just keep on coming. The flood payments are much needed. I saw that in February when my community got hit. Unfortunately, these are the usual tax arrangements for them, same with the previous government. But I think the difference here is that we are getting more payments out more quickly to more people, and we're doing that because we are working with the states, not picking fights with them, which is what the previous government did over things as important as flood payments.
You're still going to tax them, though.
These are the usual arrangements that every government has applied.
OK, Sarah, what do you think about that? I mean, small business owners, farmers, they're all affected, getting tax grants of up to $75,000 and then... You know,
well, it's not a good look, and the fine print is really that there is a right to give an exemption, and the opposition have been very quick to capitalise on this already. We may see this brought up in Peter Dutton's budget reply tonight, but certainly the deputy opposition leader has said we always made a point of it being exempt. So the fact is that that decision hasn't been made. So it does look bad, and I think to the average punter, it just looks like you're giving money with one hand and taking it with the other.
All right.